time, allow me to invite Olive Mumba to give us an overview and introduction of the CLN. Welcome, Olive.
Thank you so much, Yvonne. And if I can share my screen, please. Zainab, if you can remove the agenda so I can share.
Okay, we will remove the presentation. Please, you can do it now. You can just share and then it's okay. Thank you.
Oh, okay, let me see. It's I'm having problems with sharing. Ah, there. I think I'll be able to share now. Let's see. No, I'm having problems sharing. I think it's I'm being told something else. So maybe Zainab, if you can put up my presentation. Zainab?
I put in the presentation now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, everyone. I just wanted to say that I wasn't supposed to do this presentation. We had fortunately gotten in touch with a colleague from the Global Fund at a later stage, and unfortunately he got caught up. But he graciously shared some slides. So what I'm going to present are not slides from Ian Anso, but they are slides from the Global Fund. I may not be able to present everything as he would have presented. And in terms of questions, I may also not be able to respond to questions. But in case there's anyone who at that time of who would know this presentation better, who would be able to support me. And I would request Gemma, I know Gemma is on board, if in case there are questions that are asked, you can also help me. Who was supposed to be on this webinar, unfortunately had an emergency, so couldn't join the call. So we will try as much as possible to also fit into his shoes. So our call today is around community-led monitoring. In the past couple of years, in the last 2 years, we've been hearing a lot around community system strengthening, and specifically the role of community in terms of ensuring effective and efficient grants, especially when it comes to the Global Fund. So the Global Fund has, we all know, has invested a lot in terms of time, money, in terms of space for civil society. And this time round, we know, as we have been also, those of us that have engaged in developing the fund requests, that there's also been an opportunity to include community-led monitoring. So I have about 5 slides in front of me, and we'll start off with defining what community-led monitoring is about, and we'll also talk about what the Global Fund supports. So in terms of community-led mechanisms, which are led by civil society or communities, affected communities, we know that these are systems that gather, that analyze and use information on an ongoing basis. And this is to ensure that there is improved access to quality and impact of services. But overall, why we conduct community-led monitoring is that we want to hold the service providers and decision makers to account. This is in such a way that when there are loopholes by the data that we have collected, we are able to inform them of areas that require to be adjusted, to be reviewed, or to be improved in terms of quality services. So as we talk about community-led monitoring, we should take in cognizance that it is not the routine program monitoring. You know, we all know about monitoring and evaluation. So when we talk about community-led monitoring, It includes the development and supporting of the strengthening of community-based mechanisms that monitor the key elements, which are availability, accessibility, acceptability, and quality of services. And this can be through observatories, alert systems, scorecards. And I think we'll be given an example from Kiva and Maxim of a digital monitoring system that is called One Impact, that is being developed by the Global Fund. We know that there are other accountability mechanisms as well, like the one from Accountability International, from RIAT, from Frontline AIDS. And these systems, what they do is they check on health policies, they look at the budgets, resource tracking, monitoring of health, financing allocation decisions, and even grievance mechanisms, where you want to also document grievance mechanisms. Community-based monitoring, also, they identify the barriers to accessing services. And these barriers can be in terms of human rights violations, it can include stigma, discrimination, and confidentiality. And they also talk about age and gender-based inequalities. They can also talk about geographical and other barriers. When we talk about geographical, we mean the differences between the rural and then the urban areas. But even within the urban areas, we also know that there are disparities as well. So these tools also look at what are those barriers. And this is collected for the purpose of to make sure that there's adequate and emergency responses, that the issues are redressed, and then for research or advocacy, but mainly to improve programs and policies. Community-led monitoring systems are also tools and equipment, and they can also utilize different types of technologies. And it also includes technical support and training. We will hear more around the Global Fund and the initiative that is coming up around community-led monitoring. But in terms of the type of training, is can be through collation, cleaning and analyzing of data, and using community data to inform program decision-making and advocacy for social accountability. They also include engagement and representation in relevant governance and oversight mechanisms. And I think this can also be around the our country coordinating mechanisms. I just want to check on the translator, if I am too fast or if I'm doing fine. Please, can someone give me feedback? Let's move on to the next slide.
Yes, you can go ahead.
Okay, can I have the next slide, please?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So the translation is fine. Thank you so much. So in terms of wanted to give some examples of community-led monitoring. We have three examples here. One was around the 2014-2016 cycle, which was the Global Fund supported. It was a multi-country grant in West Africa. And this was for 11 national networks of people living with HIV. And they collected information from 25 health facilities over a period of 2 years. As you can see, it is this regional community treatment observatory. It reported significant improvements in HIV services. And you can see the way the data, the information is. And it really helped in terms of identifying what were the barriers and then also addressing those barriers. I won't go into details. But in terms of the second example, which is to our right-hand side, on the upper right-hand side, is an example of REACT. REACT is Rights Evidence Action. This was also supported by the Global Fund in Ukraine. React is a tool that has been developed by Frontline AIDS. And this allows communities to record and respond to human rights violations, specifically for HIV and TB key populations. This also was successfully piloted in various regions in Ukraine. I think they are mentioned there. And the scale up was supposed to happen in 2020. I'm not sure whether the scale up has happened, but there are other countries that React has been implemented, including Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Georgia, Moldova, and this has been through the Global Fund support. I also know that React is being implemented in other countries, though not necessarily supported through Global Fund grants. But to us, I think this is an example of how the Global Fund really listens to the communities and makes sure that our priorities are included. The next example is from Zimbabwe. It was a Global Fund technical assistance supported through the development and piloting of an adolescent girls and young women accountability framework. This was in form of a scorecard. And this was done in two districts in 2019. This pilot helped to increase the access to gender-based violence services at a one-stop center, which I think we can all see, where we have the nice young ladies smiling in front of the center. And in the current fund requests developed in March 2020, the country has proposed a scale-up of this tool in four more districts, and they will train and mentor 118 adolescent girls and young women. And I think they term them accountability champions. If we can move to the next slide, please. So as we move on to the next slide, we want to see how we optimize health and community system investments to maximize impact on malaria control and elimination. When we carry out community monitoring, it also helps us to prioritize generating high quality data. We always say that evidence is power, because for you to influence anything as civil society and as communities, you need to have information, you need to have evidence. And once you are able to generate data, that therefore can be used at all levels, including within the national systems. And this complements qualitative data. And I think this also as an example of the malaria matchbox. The other thing is that there is consideration of greater working with community-based organizations, supporting community-based organizations of the affected communities to be able to collect data amongst themselves. And this can be through community-based monitoring programs. The other area is to sustainability in promoting the long-term integration of the three diseases. And we have seen that right now we've been doing most of our work. It's HIV, it's HIV. It's malaria, it's malaria. It's TB, it's TB. But right now we are seeing more integration. And even like now, when we talk about community-based monitoring, we should be looking at ways of integrating the three diseases, HIV, TB, and malaria, but also utilizing other programs, especially those around reproductive, maternal, newborn, child, and adolescent health. Community-based monitoring also helps us to promote community health strategies. And this helps in terms of rationalizing how services are best delivered through community actors. And some of these actors are mentioned here, which are community health workers, community-based organizations, community-led organizations and groups. But the other consideration should be around investment in human resources, in terms of who is going to gather the data, training of them, and this should be done in a strategically with a sustainability plan, ensuring that when the project is running, this we look about, we also consider what will happen in the future after the project ends. So we need to build the systems, and we also need to invest in human resources. Let us move on to the next slide, please. The next slide also talks about it's a continuation, but we'll be looking at how community-based monitoring helps us in assessing and addressing inequalities, human rights, and gender-related barriers to malaria services. There is a Global Fund technical brief on malaria, gender, and human rights, which acknowledges high-risk populations, and each country would have different types of high-risk populations or underserved populations that are differently affected by socioeconomic and cultural factors, and that increase risks to malaria or pose barriers to access malaria prevention, diagnosis, and treatment services. It also helps us to know who is left behind. And through the stratification of data, I think when we say stratification, I think it means pulling down the data, wanting to know what the data means, analyzing it. So that helps us to know who is left behind in terms of the gender and age disaggregation. And it also helps us to understand what are the equity barriers. I will not go into details because I think I'm seeing a lot of malaria language. But it's all around identifying who is being left behind, who needs more support than the other people. How can we support those that are more left behind? It also helps us in terms of addressing gender and human rights barriers. And in terms of focusing on the underserved population, in terms of community system strengthening, we all know that communities have a critical role in designing and delivery of services, in reaching the underserved or those that are left behind and the high risk populations. So this helps in terms of meeting the demands and addressing human rights and gender related barriers and maximizing outreach and impact. Community-led monitoring can also help identify, address bottlenecks and gaps in service provision. We will hear more from Ayo, who will give us an example of the Matchbox experience in Nigeria, but we'll also hear more about One Impact in DRC. They will tell us more around what were some of the critical issues and how they were addressed. Can we move on to the next slide, please? This is the last slide. And as I mentioned earlier, that currently the Global Fund is by next year, January 2021 up to December 2023, they have a strategic initiative, which is around community-led monitoring. And there are two rationales. One is to support the uptake and use of community-led mechanisms, wanting to know, you know, who is out there, but also making sure that these are incorporated within the Global Fund processes. But they also want to support innovative use of data to strengthen partnerships. We know that already so many civil society and community organizations are implementing community-based monitoring, and what they want to do is, through the Global Fund grant, strengthen the innovative use of data. They have identified in Africa, I think we have around four countries. If I can remember correctly, we have Zimbabwe, we have Burkina Faso, and I think there are like other two countries. I think we'll share the names of the countries. If there's anyone, Gemma, if you can help me, maybe if you know the countries, If you could share that. Through the CRG, that's the Community Rights and Gender, they have set aside $3 million, and it is a new component. They have three objectives, and this is to improve uptake and use of community-led monitoring. They are also wanting to strengthen integration of community-led monitoring into disease responses and national strategies. And also they want to generate evidence on the impact of community-led monitoring on service delivery. Then in terms of the profile, we have 34 countries and 7 multi-country grants, and they'll be looking at all the three diseases. And in terms of activities that will be supported through this technical support strategic initiative, they'll be looking at developing new tools, rolling out existing tools, for example, REACT, One Impact, the Accountability International Scorecard, and others. They are also looking at community surveys, community scorecards, training communities in data analysis and use, also feedback sessions with healthcare workers. We should be on the lookout. What they'll be doing is, of course, they will start off with these selected countries, but I think where technical support is needed, they have highlighted some other additional countries. So we should be looking out for this technical assistance. But for us to be able to get this technical assistance, we need to make sure for those countries that are now going into grant making, or those that have not yet finalized their fund request, is to make sure that community-led monitoring is one of the priority activities within our grants. So it is up to us to really push and prioritize community-led monitoring. And the Global Fund again has provided us with technical support. And with that, I come to the end of this presentation. Thank you so much. Back to you, Yvonne. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Olive, for the great presentation. Thank you for stepping in for Keith from Global Fund. You've really done a great and wonderful job. And I hope, I know CLM, community-led monitoring, is new to most of us. And I know this is a very good platform for us to know more about community-led monitoring, especially in the context of malaria. At least we have seen some community-led monitoring intervention in HIV and TB, but for malaria, it's not a very common practice. So thank you so much for that presentation. And I know you talked about some of the tools that are used during community-led monitoring. So at this time, let me invite...
Before you move on, Yvonne, yes. Can I quite kindly request Gemma to come in? Just give her like 5 minutes, because Gemma may have more updated information. So Gemma, Zainab, if you can unmute Gemma before we move on to One Impact, please. Thank you.
Okay. So Gemma, this is Olivia. We will activate your microphone now. So your microphone is activated on our side, Gemma. You can... And thank you so much. I can see it now.
Perfect. Thank you for that presentation, Olive. I think you presented this community-led monitoring strategic initiative very well. So that's exciting to share that information. So the countries for that strategic initiative, we're looking at, I think, 5 to 7 countries. They are not definite yet, and they are still being discussed. But we are looking at having at least 2 in Africa at the moment, one in Francophone Africa and one in English-speaking Africa. Not finalized, but that is the current thinking. And also one malaria-focused grant as well. So looking at HIV, TB, and definitely having one country where the focus will be on community-led monitoring for malaria. So that's exciting. I hope we can share more very soon. Thanks. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much, Gemma, for that information, and I hope we'll be on the lookout for those countries. Yeah. So at this time, let me invite Kiva to give us more explanation and present to us One Impact, which is a community-led monitoring tool. Kiva, you're welcome.
Thank you, and good morning and good afternoon, rather, colleagues, and thank you in particular to IANASO and Impact Sante Aspic for inviting SOBTV Partnership to be part of this conversation today on building community-led monitoring systems for improved quality health services to the malaria communities. We're really happy to be here with you. So as mentioned, my name is Kiva, and I work on a portfolio of work called Community Rights and Gender. And one component of our work that really links TB human rights and accountability is community-led monitoring of the TB response. And so again, we're very happy to be with you here today. And next slide, please. So I'll divide my talk into three. So firstly, I will talk about community-led monitoring and what it is and why it is important to the TB response. And I wanted to do this because there's a lot of confusion around this work, and it really was like an uphill learning curve for us. And I wanted to share that experience with you. Then secondly, I will talk about the One Impact community-led monitoring framework that we developed and the digital platform for community-led monitoring. And lastly, I'll talk a little bit about some of the results of the pilot projects, lessons learned, and some next steps. So next slide, please. So back to this question about what is community-led monitoring of in the TB response in particular. So again, I thought it was really important to answer this question because for us, there was a lot of confusion. And so I thought I would start off by saying what it is not, having been really inspired by the work of ITPC Global. So community-led monitoring in TB is not monitoring TB community activities by healthcare workers, and it's not M&E that includes TB-centered indicators. Rather, in the end, what we've concluded is that it is all about promoting and protecting human rights through the empowerment of people affected by TB to know and claim their rights, and the engagement of people affected by TB to design and monitor human right indicators that they think are important to the TB response for advocacy and action and enhanced accountability. Next slide, please. So now to the question as to why it is important in TB. So let's look at the Declaration of the Rights of People Affected by TB and the UN Political Declaration. Both of these documents were really helpful for us in order to be able to position community-led monitoring. So in the declaration, it is stated, among many other things, that people affected by TB have the right to information, participation, to health, to freedom from discrimination, and the right to confidentiality. And in the UN Political Declaration, heads of state and government acknowledge the various socio-cultural and human right barriers to TB services, especially for those who are vulnerable. This then raises the question about the availability of data on these socio-cultural and human rights barriers to access. So in other words, we had to ask ourselves, what do we concretely know about these human rights barriers and how they contribute to the persistent challenge that we have in TB of finding the missing people with TB? Well, the answer to that was, while we really might acknowledge these fundamental human rights, the importance of them and the barriers, is that while we might acknowledge them, we do not systematically collect the data and therefore use evidence to overcome these barriers. And I say this based on the cross-cutting findings of what we called the Community Rights and Gender Assessment. So these were assessments, they're qualitative assessments that we conducted in 13 countries under the Global Fund Strategic Initiative to find the missing people with TB. And these assessments essentially aim to evaluate the human rights and gender barriers. And these assessments revealed, as cross-cutting findings across these 13 countries, is that number one, people affected by TB do not know, and therefore claim their rights. That duty bearers are unaware of the links between human rights and TB, that accountability mechanisms to respond to human rights barriers do not exist, and therefore data, let alone electronic data on human rights barriers, is. So this is really where community-led monitoring came in for us. So next slide, please. So again, based on these cross-cutting findings of the CRG assessment, which clearly indicated gaps in the TB response in terms of engagement and human rights barriers, so we developed, in response to these findings, number one, a community-led monitoring framework and the community-led monitoring digital tool that you heard about, One Impact. So the framework, among other things, really outlines like definitions and concepts, objectives, principles, risks, success factors, among other things. And the reason why it is really still in draft format, let's say, is because we really wanted it to be informed by the country experiences. And so by the end of this year, we will have a lot of experience from the 13 countries that have been implementing it. And so we will have a very comprehensive framework at the end of it based on country and community experience. And then simultaneously, we developed a tool that is in continuous development based on, again, country and community experience. And you'll be glad to know that IHNASA really helped us to develop both this framework and the tool along the way. Next slide, please. So before going into the platform itself, I just really wanted to touch upon the framework, because what we learned over time is that while it's important to develop a tool, it's actually the framework and the intervention itself that is a lot more important. The tool at the end of the day is just a tool, and I'm certainly not diminishing the tool, but it's rather that the intervention that we give the value that is needed towards the intervention itself. So today we're currently defining community-led monitoring in TB using this One Impact tool is engaging and empowering people affected by TB to know their rights and report human rights barriers, preventing people from being diagnosed and successfully treated for a rights-based, people-centered, accountable, and equitable TB response. You'll see here that the language that we're using is very sort of human rights-centric. And I will say that this definition is forever changing. And again, it is really based on the experiences of countries and what it is that they are interested in monitoring. So now in terms of objectives, this was helpful for us in terms of the conversations we were having at national level with strategic partners. It was important for us to outline what it is that we are trying to achieve. And so at an individual level, our aims were really to empower people affected by TB to know and claim their rights and to facilitate their engagement in the TB response. And then at a monitoring, surveillance, and advocacy level, we really wanted to support the generation of data on human rights barriers to bolster and to provide new information on TB within the ME system, and also to generate information, probably even more importantly, for community-based advocacy. And then finally, at a programmatic level, it was really important for us to generate information on the availability, the accessibility, acceptability, and quality of TB services that Olive mentioned, namely the right to health, to inform the design of programmatic interventions, which would then ultimately help us to evaluate our interventions and to overcome barriers to access. Next slide, please. So I wanted to show you what countries are currently monitoring. So they are currently monitoring the right to health, so the availability, accessibility, and quality of TB care and support services. And they're essentially asking questions like, do these services exist in insufficient quantity? Are they physically, geographically, economically accessible? Are they respectful of medical ethics and scientifically appropriate and relevant? So all of this information, if you think about it, is really important, not just for community advocates, but also for health systems. Because at the end of the day, it is the responsibility of the health system and governments to make sure the services are available, accessible, acceptable, and of good quality. I will say also that countries are now, in my experience, starting to think beyond the right to health and thinking about the importance of monitoring other rights, such as the right to non-discrimination and the right to privacy and confidentiality. So next slide, please. So here's the One Impact platform, and it really consists of three modules, all of which speak to each other. So number one, we have the app, and it's for people affected by TB, and it has four components. These components allow people to access essential information on TB and on their rights. Again, human rights being central to this community-led monitoring piece of work. And it also allows them to allocate the nearest TB care and support services and information about these services. It also allows them to connect with virtual communities like peer support groups or national networks or even regional and global networks. Because as we all know, the TB journey is and can be a very lonely one. And then finally, to the crux of what we're trying to do, it allows people to report the human right barriers to access that they experience. So then the second module is what we're calling is the first responder inbox. So as people report barriers, they are recorded in real time in this first responder inbox. And this first responder's inbox then allows the first responders, which tend to be community health workers, to track, coordinate responses, and also to report the outcome of these community responses. And then finally, we have what we call the accountability dashboard, which aggregates all of the data that is being reported from the app to the inbox, and it allows them to collect and collate all of these indicators on, number one, the usability of the app, because it's important to understand how useful the app is from the perspective of the affected community. And secondly, the efficiencies of the community responses. We all know that community responses are efficient, but in this scenario, what we're able to do is to show how efficient the community responses are. And then thirdly, it allows us to collect our community monitoring data on, again, the availability, accessibility, acceptability, and quality of TB services, all of which can be used in different ways to inform advocacy and programmatic decision making. Next slide, please. So I'm not sure if I'm still seeing the slide I was talking about. The next slide is more on the features. So I think I'll continue in any case. But the features of the app now, I wish admittedly that I had brought Dura Technologies I was smart enough to think about doing this in collaboration with them, because they have a lot more information on these features. So I'd be more than happy to connect anyone with Dura Technologies, because again, Dura Technologies really helped us to develop the platform. In fact, they power the solution. And so if I were to think about the app in terms of their features, and there's some sort of cool things that are integrated, like artificial intelligent chatbots. It's very easy for the community or whomever's developing the tool to create their own content, in other words, to design the app. And there's also, it can also be integrated into different social media. Now, in terms of the inbox, that was on the previous slide, it is an inbox that the aim of the features was essentially to make sure that it was intuitive, so make it really user-friendly. So at the end of the day, what it now looks like is like an email. And it also has an innovative chat feature built in, which allows the first responder to communicate to the person affected by TB in an anonymous way. Thank you. And now to this slide, this works well. This is what we call the accountability dashboard that I mentioned. And in the accountability dashboard, there are some nice features, like, so we have interactive charts to capture the indicators themselves against the AAQ framework. You can filter the data by age, gender, key population, depending on how people register when they download the app. And you can generate reports in real time and have drill down maps. But there's a lot of different and very creative features in there that can be used. Now, quickly, next slide in terms of implementation. Sorry, thank you. So essentially, both the intervention and the technology, what we did was we followed the phases of implementation recommended by the World Health Organization in their digital handbook on technologies for TB. And it essentially, countries have followed 7 phases of implementation, from conducting the needs and feasibility assessment to M&E to scale up. And really what the process relies on heavily is on generating political will and a multi-sectoral engagement, because as we know, what we need in TB is a response that isn't just medicalized. We understand that people have different needs, and therefore we need to involve different actors in the response. And then each phase is supported by different tools and templates that we've developed to support decision-making processes along the way. And finally, I just wanted to let you know that the pilot projects in general have taken 1 year to conduct. Next slide, please. Great. So we're currently supporting 13 countries to pilot test the intervention and the tool under this strategic initiative to find the missing people with TB, which is supported, which is Global Fund led, and it's also supported by USAID with co-financing support. And you will see here that within 5 of the countries, whether it's through Global Fund grants or USAID loan agreements and the Stop TB Partnership Challenge Facility for Civil Society grant mechanism, we are supporting these five countries to either expand the intervention or to take the intervention to scale, which is very encouraging. Next slide, please. Now, in terms of results, in terms of community participation and community system strengthening, we've seen a really important shift, in my opinion. So today, as a result of these really discrete projects, over 3,500 people affected by TB are engaged in community-led monitoring. In other words, they're engaged in novel ways to support the TB response, which go beyond the traditional service delivery support that we are used to in TB. And then relatedly, we've got over 3,500 people affected by TB that now have easy access to information on TB, which was not always the case, that are connected to virtual communities and that are claiming their rights, all of which, again, is new and novel in TB and also in alignment with our global commitments to transform the response to be rights-based and people-centered. Now, in terms of addressing human rights data gaps, 13 countries more or less have now successfully adopted the One Impact digital platform and are now collecting real-time electronic data on human rights to access for their strategic advocacy and programmatic decision-making. Next slide. And final slide. That should actually say results, lessons learned, but in terms of, so my apologies for that. So in terms of the lessons learned, at a local level, what we found was that data gets used really well because communities have always been and continue to be responding to these barriers to access. However, using the data at a health systems level was a different story and it was trickier. And as a result of this, this is the reason why we started categorizing our barriers according to the AAAQ framework, meaning availability, accessibility, acceptability, and quality, because then the information that was then generated was then able to be used by the health system more easily. So that was one major lesson learned. Another major lesson is that ensuring the rights and protections of populations engaged in CLM is really an ethical and programmatic imperative, and that mitigating the risk to data privacy and security is therefore really critical. And so we're now working with Professor Brian Citra, who is a professor of law, who's really helping us to mitigate those risks. So it's another lesson that we learned along the way. And then finally, I think from a country perspective, what was really important with regards to technology is that country ownership of the platform and the data and being free to be able to adapt and change as they needed was really important. So therefore, in terms of next steps, we are working with Joy Technologies to make sure to give countries full ownership of the platform to support, should they wish, to use the source code and to integrate the source code into a local server so that it is fully owned by the country. And that they've also developed a smart setup which allows countries to change the information within the system very easily. Furthermore, as I mentioned, we're updating the platform, the framework, and the implementation guide based on country experience. We're working with Brian Citro, as I mentioned, to introduce measures to mitigate any risks to data privacy. And finally, we're supporting countries to scale up or expand on these activities, whether it's through the Global Fund, with Global Fund support or USAID support or StopTB support. So on that note, I will conclude and thank you for your attention and interest in One Impact. And we'll be happy to take any questions, whether it's today or any other day. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Kiva, for the great presentation on One Impact in the context of TB and also highlighting the importance of community-led monitoring. I believe for the malaria community, we are learning something and also look forward to engaging into CLM initiative. So now we are going to hear experiences from communities and civil society organizations on how they have been implementing the community-led monitoring initiative. And we'll hear from Maxime Lunga from DRC, who will be also sharing with us TB One Impact. Welcome, Maxime.
Thank you very much. I think I want to speak in French because I'm in DRC, the French country. Merci beaucoup pour la parole. Je vais commencer par remercier les organisateurs, IANASSO et Impact Santé Afrique, pour cette opportunité nous accorder afin d'échanger sur cette expérience basée sur la surveillance à base communautaire de la riposte à la tuberculose qu'on a menée ici en RDC, plus précisément à Kinshasa en 2019. Je suis Maxime Lunga, secrétaire national de CAD. CAD, c'est l'association des anciens tuberculés au Congo, dénommée Club des Amis d'Amiens. Merci beaucoup pour ça. Diapo suivant.
Bonjour Maxime, c'est Impact Santé Afrique. C'est juste, tu vois, on va juste expliquer aux anglophones comment changer pour aller sur l'anglais. Hi everyone, we will just explain to you how to switch the language on Zoom and go to the English so that you can listen in English as Maxime is speaking in French. So first you go to, if you look under your screen, there's a little plus that you see. And when you click on plus, you see there's languages. And then you click on English so that you can be on the English channel. And then you mute the original audio. So Zainabu is going to write that on the chat right now so that you can follow. Thank you. Donc, Maxime, à vous. Merci beaucoup.
D'accord, merci. Donc, je disais que je suis Maxime Lunga de la RDC. Je suis un ancien tuberculeux et je suis secrétaire national du CAD, Club des Amis d'Amiens, donc une association des anciens tuberculeux au Congo. Et je remercie Anasso et Impact Santé Afrique pour cette opportunité nous accorder pour échanger sur notre expérience que nous avons menée à Kinshasa en 2019 sur la surveillance à base communautaire dans la riposte à la TB à travers l'outil digital One Impact. Diapo suivant. Donc, cette expérience émane d'une évaluation CRJ qu'on a menée en 2018, donc Communauté, Droits humains et genre en TB. Cette évaluation est conduite par notre organisation sous l'orientation stratégique du Programme national de lutte contre la tuberculose a démontré que les communautés touchées par la tuberculose ne sont pas systématiquement et significativement impliquées dans la lutte contre la tuberculose. C'est le cas de beaucoup de pays aussi. Les communautés affectées par la tuberculose ne fournissent pas de commentaires, donc sur les obstacles. Cela veut dire qu'on subit la prise en charge de la tuberculose qui est verticale du programme et directement aux bénéficiaires et on n'a pas de commentaires à faire là-dessus. Même si on a quelques obstacles, on ne sait pas les signaler. Et puis, tous ceux qui travaillent dans l'environnement légal, ils ignorent les liens de COVID-19. Ce sont les données, les évidences qui font qui donnent la machine aux États de lutter contre le COVID. Donc, pour la tuberculose, ce n'est pas le cas. La collecte systématique des obstacles n'est pas prise en compte. Les communautés non plus ne peuvent pas renseigner et donc les données communautaires en temps réel sur les obstacles ne sont pas collectées et cela empêche que les gens soient diagnostiqués et soignés à temps. Et il n'y a pas non plus de données électroniques, on a toujours beaucoup plus les données manuelles. C'est vrai que maintenant il y a les DHSD, mais on n'a pas assez d'indicateurs sur la tuberculose, donc il est très difficile de renseigner sur le diagnostic, le traitement et le soin. Dia. Par conséquent, dia suivant. Diapo suivant. Donc, par conséquent, les personnes touchées par la tuberculose ne sont pas engagées dans la tuberculose et la réponse de la tuberculose donc n'est pas toujours efficace parce que c'est pas fondé sur des évidences, donc c'est pas centré vraiment sur les patients. Ici chez nous en RDC, la prévalence même de la tuberculose n'est pas très bien connue, donc c'est pour dire que la réponse à la tuberculose elle est tout à fait suppositoire, c'est pas vraiment très bien efficace. Donc, il est difficile pour le gouvernement de collecter et d'analyser manuellement suffisamment de données pour éclairer les décisions programmatiques à grande échelle, ce qui fait que la planification pays a toujours des gaps en termes d'efficacité et en termes de résultats. Ceci nous a alors amené à mettre en place cette expérience de la surveillance à base communautaire pour commencer maintenant à collecter les données sur les obstacles qu'expérimentent les personnes touchées par la tuberculose. Diapo suivant. Next slide. Voilà. Donc, nous avons mis en œuvre sur le soutien financier des Stop Partnership avec l'assistance des biotechnologies et des Stop TB. Le One Impact que nous avons adapté, One Impact TB Tolongi, sous l'orientation stratégique du programme national de lutte contre la tuberculose à Kinshasa. Et cela dans 29 établissements de santé. La ville de Kinshasa compte plus de 140 établissements de santé, mais dans notre projet pilote, nous avons ciblé 29.
Oui. Excuse-moi de te déranger, je suis vraiment désolée, mais on va peut-être te demander si on peut recommencer, parce qu'il y a eu un petit problème technique avec la traduction en anglais. Donc, les organisations peuvent vraiment comprendre ce que tu disais. Donc, je suis désolée, on va recommencer au début. Il est bon? OK. Yeah, so we'll start over, and then this time, I think, let us know that the translation should be working now very well. So we apologize for this technical issue with the translation. Okay, go ahead, Maxime. Thank you so much.
Okay, now it's good? Yeah. Voilà, je disais donc que je suis Maxime Lung. Je suis survivant de la tuberculose et responsable de l'organisation Club des Amis d'Amiens, donc en sigle CAD. C'est une association nationale des anciens tuberculés ici au Congo. Et donc, je remercie IANASO et Impact Santé Afrique pour cette opportunité qui m'est accordée pour partager sur l'expérience de la surveillance à base communautaire de la riposte à la TB que nous avons menée en RDC, précisément à Kinshasa, en 2019. Dia suivant. Donc, cette expérience, nous l'avons amenée sur base de l'évaluation CRJ qu'on a aussi conduit par mon association en 2018, donc l'évaluation communauté genre et droits humains et en TB, qui a démontré que les personnes touchées par la tuberculose ne sont pas systématiquement et significativement impliquées dans toutes les phases de la programmation de la lutte contre la tuberculose ici, donc dans l'élaboration, la planification, la mise en œuvre et l'évaluation, non. Et puis, les communautés tuberculeuses affectées ne fournissent pas de commentaires sur les obstacles qui les empêchent d'être diagnostiquées, donc parce qu'il n'y a pas un mécanisme au travers duquel on peut renseigner sur les obstacles. Et donc, ici, donc, on subit la prise en charge telle que verticalisée par le programme. Cela veut dire que les directives sont données et puis tout le monde se met dans les directives. Mais s'il y a des obstacles, on ne sait pas les renseigner, et aussi dans les personnes qui gèrent l'environnement légal, ils ignorent carrément les droits à la santé, les liens qui existent entre les droits à la santé et la tuberculose. C'est beaucoup plus le VIH qui est mis en exergue, mais la tuberculose, ces liens-là n'est pas fait au niveau de l'environnement légal. Et puis, on n'a pas ici au Congo un système, une collecte systématique de données sur les obstacles, par manque d'outils, par manque de mécanismes, et les données communautaires ne sont pas collectées en temps réel, et surtout sur les obstacles, parce qu'il y a seulement quelques informations qui peuvent être collectées à travers les infirmiers, mais c'est vraiment très tard, et il n'y a pas de données électroniques sur les obstacles. Donc tout ça, ça donne comme conséquence, dia suivant, donc l'engagement des communautés touchées par la tuberculose n'est pas effectif. Dia suivant.
Maxime.
Oui.
Voilà. En fait, pour des raisons d'interprétation, est-ce que vous pourriez parler plus lentement, s'il vous plaît, pour faciliter la traduction?
Je vous en prie. I'm sorry for the... Because our webinar is bilingue, so that I chose just to speak in French. But OK. Donc, je disais que, par conséquent, non, le dia suivant. Voilà, les personnes touchées par la tuberculose ne sont pas systématiquement engagées dans la conception, la mise en œuvre et le suivi de la riposte, parce que tout simplement, il n'y a pas de mécanisme pour permettre à ce que ces personnes participent dans la lutte contre la tuberculose à cause de tous ces obstacles qu'on ne sait pas renseigner. Et ce qui fait que la réponse à la tuberculose n'est pas efficace, parce que ce n'est pas basé ou fondé sur des preuves, des évidences. Et donc, c'est vertical, et tout ce qu'on a comme orientation, ce sont les orientations médicales. Et ce qui fait que, tellement qu'on manque des évidences, la réponse ne peut pas être efficace, parce qu'il doit y avoir toujours des gaps pour l'atteinte de résultats. Il se fait même qu'ici, en RDC, la prévalence de la tuberculose n'est pas connue, alors que nous sommes un pays qui, en moyenne par an, peut dépister plus de 200 000 cas. Il est donc difficile au gouvernement de collecter et d'analyser les données qui sont collectées de manière manuelle. Ça, c'est difficile parce que c'est un grand pays, comme vous le savez. Donc, il était important que nous puissions mettre en œuvre cette expérience pilote qui a été proposée par Stop TB Partnership, donc la surveillance avance communautaire que nous avons bien adaptée à One Impact TB Tolongi. Dia suivant. Alors, cette expérience, nous l'avons mise grâce au financement de Stop TB Partnership et à l'assistance technique de Dure Technology et Stop TB Partnership, et aussi grâce aux orientations stratégiques du Programme national de lutte contre la tuberculose. Alors, nous avons choisi 29 sites, donc 29 établissements de santé sur les 149 qui comptent la ville de Kinshasa. Donc, il y avait un critère dans les choix des établissements de santé, donc des centres de santé, vu que c'était un projet pilote. Et nous avons choisi un modèle non assisté, cela veut dire les patients eux-mêmes devaient utiliser l'application One Impact pour signaler les obstacles et les barrières qu'ils expérimentaient. Et nous avons travaillé donc avec 265 patients comme utilisateurs de l'application One Impact TB Tolongi. Et il y a eu alors, en termes de communautaires qui devaient accompagner pour répondre aux questions de manière immédiate, donc, nous avons 60 acteurs communautaires qui sont basés dans le centre de santé en raison des 10 acteurs communautaires par établissement de santé. Et nous avons 10 membres de l'association Club des Amis d'Amiens, donc CAD, qui étaient là maintenant pour collecter les données, donc travailler sur l'outil Dashboard. Je pense que Keva vous a parlé de l'application One Impact, des inbox et des dashboards. Donc, l'application est utilisée par les 265 utilisateurs. Les inbox, donc, dans la plateforme, étaient utilisés par les 60 acteurs communautaires et les dashboards, comme tableau de bord, étaient utilisés par les 10 membres du Club des Amis d'Amiens. Et c'est là, dans la période allant du mois d'avril au mois de décembre 2019. Dia suivant. OK. Voilà. Donc, ça aussi, Keva en a parlé. Donc, nous avons passé toutes ces étapes, de 1 jusqu'à 6e étape de l'implémentation pilote de One Impact, en commençant par l'évaluation des faisabilités, des besoins, pour voir comment adapter notre outil dans les contextes du pays selon les directives nationales de la RDC, donc en matière de la tuberculose. Et nous avons passé à la troisième étape, cela veut dire définir les indicateurs à suivre, et ça c'était fait avec les malades. Et quatrième étape, donc c'était la formation des utilisateurs d'abord, et aussi des infirmiers de la tuberculose dans les 29 centres de santé sélectionnés. Et puis, la formation des 60 membres de la communauté pour utiliser les inbox. Et puis, la formation des 10 membres du Club des Amis d'Amiens pour l'utilisation des dashboards. Et nous avons lancé One Impact que nous avons suivi pendant 6 mois, donc de juillet en juin 2019, en décembre plutôt, juillet en décembre 2019. Et à la fin du projet, donc, nous avons fait notre évaluation finale, mais nous avons assuré donc le suivi et évaluation avec les résultats que nous avons récoltés à la fin de ces projets pilotes. Dia suivant. Voilà comment est-ce que se présente le cadre de responsabilisation pour voir comment est-ce que le One Impact fonctionne et a fonctionné avec cette expérience pilote en RDC. Donc, nous avons les personnes affectées par la tuberculose au niveau des services de santé qui, eux, disposent de smartphones avec l'application One Impact. Et à chaque fois, ils sont confrontés à des obstacles ou à des barrières. Ils signalent les problèmes aux membres de la communauté de l'association Club des Amis d'Amiens, donc les 60 membres qui sont tout près d'eux. Et ces membres, ils vont faire les liens avec les problèmes et les services de la tuberculose pour essayer de trouver des solutions pertinentes directement. Et à ce moment-là, donc, l'observance et l'adhérence au traitement pour les malades qui ont un problème est assurée. Et directement dans les dashboards, l'équipe de Club des Amis d'Amiens voit les problèmes qui ont été signalés par les personnes affectées par la tuberculose. Il voit aussi les problèmes qui ont été résolus par les membres de la communauté. Et à son tour, il fait le rapport pour alors mener les plaidoyers. La première cible des plaidoyers, c'est le Programme national de lutte contre la tuberculose, parce qu'en ce moment-là, nous devons bien faciliter la prise en charge des malades, tous les obstacles qui peuvent être les obstacles du système de santé ou les obstacles liés aux frais doivent être abordés avec les programmes pour les décisions programmatiques adéquates qui peuvent permettre l'amélioration de la prise en charge de la tuberculose, que ce soit une prise en charge de qualité. Donc voilà le cadre de responsabilisation commençant par les personnes affectées par la tuberculose jusqu'au programme et c'est comme ça qu'on a fonctionné. Dia suivant. Alors, qu'est-ce que nous avons suivi? Nous avons les 4A, les 3A et les AAQ en anglais, Availability, Accessibility, Acceptability and Quality. Et en français, c'est DAAQ, c'est Disponibilité, Accessibilité, Acceptabilité et Qualité. Et exemple, au niveau des disponibilités, nous avons suivi les obstacles liés à la rupture des stocks de médicaments dans les centres de santé. Donc, si les malades expérimentent cela, parce que nous savons que ça a une influence dans le cadre de la prise en charge de la tuberculose. Aussi, au niveau de l'accessibilité, on a suivi, par exemple, l'accessibilité géographique, la localisation des centres de santé, donc des structures de prise en charge de la tuberculose par rapport au domicile des personnes affectées par la tuberculose, à distance, tout ce qui peut être pris dans le cadre de l'accessibilité géographique, mais aussi l'accessibilité financière, le coût pour accéder aux soins de la tuberculose. Parce que ici au Congo, les directives nationales édictent que le traitement de la tuberculose est gratuit. Mais avant d'accéder au traitement, il faut d'abord être diagnostiqué. Mais alors, les diagnostics, la consultation pour être diagnostiqué, ça a un coût. Donc, nous avons aussi suivi ces problèmes de barrières-là. L'acceptabilité aussi. Nous avons suivi la stigma au niveau des centres de santé, au niveau de la communauté, au niveau des familles, au niveau des liens de travail, au niveau des liens dans les écoles et tout. Donc, ça aussi, c'était des indicateurs à suivre dans notre application One Impact TB2Longi. Et au niveau des qualités, nous avons aussi suivi les effets indésirables des médicaments, parce que nous savons qu'il y a pas mal de malades de la tuberculose qui ont tendance à interrompre les traitements à cause des effets indésirables des médicaments. Et nous voulons voir si, en termes de qualité des services, si c'est pris en charge, ou si l'adhésion au traitement, l'accueil et tout le reste. Donc voilà un peu ce qu'on a suivi dans les One Impact TB Tolongi à Kinshasa. Dia suivant. Voilà, on a au total ici, nous avons travaillé avec 366 personnes qui ont téléchargé l'application. Nous avons des personnes atteintes de la tuberculose, les membres du club des amis d'Amien. Et au total, nous avons eu 1542 obstacles signalés par les personnes atteintes de la tuberculose. Donc, les 265 utilisateurs de One Impact. Mais au total, donc, seulement sur les 265, 171 personnes ont, donc 11 personnes affectées par la tuberculose ont déclaré au moins une fois les obstacles, ce qui nous donne 46%, qui n'est pas moindre, qui est quand même un bon résultat pour un projet pilote. Alors, en termes de résultats aussi sur les indicateurs qu'on a suivis, Dia. Dia suivant. Dia suivant. Donc, là, j'étais au niveau de... Voilà. Alors, ici, nous avons la répartition des barrières. Donc, vous allez comprendre que beaucoup de malades de la tuberculose ont signalé les obstacles en rapport avec la qualité des services. 59% ont fustigé la qualité des services. Et puis, vous avez 16% qui ont rapporté les obstacles en termes de la disponibilité des services de la tuberculose. Donc, ça a permis à ce qu'on comprenne que la qualité est très pauvre en RDC parce que 59% des utilisateurs ont signaler ces problèmes de qualité des services. Dia. Dia suivant. Voilà, en termes de disponibilité des services, vous allez voir que le problème de rupture de médicaments est sérieux parce que si le 100% des problèmes de disponibilité d'accessibilité, d'acceptabilité et la qualité des services, 16% des personnes atteintes de tuberculose qui ont utilisé One Impact ont signalé les problèmes en rapport avec la rupture des stocks de médicaments. Et ça, c'est vraiment très dangereux parce qu'on ne sait pas soigner les malades quand il y a rupture de médicaments. Et quand c'est intempestible, les gens peuvent être démotivés de continuer à suivre le traitement et donc l'adhérence au traitement, l'observance au traitement peut être entamée par l'héritage des traitements et on risque d'avoir beaucoup de pertes de malades ou de perdus de vue sur les malades déjà enregistrés qui peuvent être bien soignés. Bien suivant. Alors, en termes d'accès, nous avons ici différents problèmes qui ont été signalés comme obstacles, mais ce qui vient avant tout, c'est le problème des distances. Les structures de prise en charge de la tuberculose sont plus éloignées que les malades. Et donc, dans cette distance-là, il est difficile qu'un malade soit régulier au traitement et ça peut aussi amener à l'interruption du traitement. Il y a aussi les problèmes des contraintes de transport. Quand c'est éloigné, il faut payer les transports. Un tuberculé, beaucoup plus dans les cas de notre pays, la RDC, ce sont des personnes devenues démunies, donc difficile d'avoir des moyens pour assurer les transports durant 6 mois de traitement, durant 9 mois de traitement. Donc, il est difficile comme ça, dans ces contextes, que ces obstacles permettent une bonne prise en charge. Nous avons aussi le pourcentage, 15% des personnes qui ont signalé les frais de consultation. C'est un blocage. Quand quelqu'un a la tuberculose et qu'il vient au centre de santé, mais si pour accéder au traitement et au diagnostic d'abord et au traitement ensuite, il doit payer. Et quand il est démuni, quand il n'a rien, donc il va rentrer à la maison et donc il ne va pas accéder aux soins. Donc ça, c'est réel. C'est vrai que nous avons aussi d'autres problèmes, mais les problèmes de distanciation, les problèmes de coûts de transport, les problèmes de frais de consultation, ça, c'est des barrières au niveau de l'accessibilité qui est vraiment très remarquée et ça a été signalé par les personnes atteintes de tuberculose qui ont utilisé le One Impact. Dia suivant. La stigmatisation aussi, ça a été signalé. Première stigmatisation, c'est au niveau des familles. 29% les malades sont stigmatisés dans leur famille. Mais on a aussi été surpris, on a vraiment été surpris de voir que la stigmatisation en deuxième position, c'est au niveau des centres de santé, des structures de prise en charge de la tuberculose. 23% des malades ont signalé d'expérimenter la stigmatisation au niveau des centres de santé, auprès des médecins, auprès des infirmiers. C'est vraiment désolant. Et puis nous avons 20% qui ont signalé la stigmatisation au niveau de la communauté, mais il y a aussi quand même 19% de l'auto-stigmatisation. Donc, cela veut dire que la stigmatisation, c'est un grand blocage en soi. Et si on ne fait pas attention, c'est difficile qu'on puisse bien prendre en charge les malades de la tuberculose. Dia. Et puis, je pense que là, c'était par rapport, pour la stigmatisation. Dia suivant. Alors, ça, c'est la qualité. Je vais prendre l'obstacle qui est plus grand, c'est toujours ici les effets secondaires, donc les effets indésirables du médicament. Beaucoup de malades ont signalé que leurs effets indésirables au médicament ne sont pas pris en charge par les programmes nationaux de lutte contre la tuberculose. On leur prescrit les médicaments qu'ils doivent acheter eux-mêmes. Donc ça aussi, c'est un problème que nous avons pu collecter à travers de notre surveillance à base communautaire. Dia suivant, donc c'est très important. Maintenant, comment on a utilisé ces informations? Donc, au niveau local, on a travaillé avec la coordination de lutte contre la tuberculose ici à Kinshasa. On l'a impliqué pour la résolution des différents problèmes à son niveau. Ça, c'était avec les responsables de la maladie dans la province. Et puis, nous avons travaillé au niveau des systèmes de santé avec les programmes, pour instruire, pour élaborer une directive instruisant les infirmiers à améliorer l'accueil. Parce qu'il y avait la stigmatisation, il y avait les problèmes de rupture de médicaments, mais il y avait aussi les problèmes des effets indésirables que les malades ont signalés. Et au niveau national, nous avons travaillé avec les programmes. Et les évidences, les preuves, les résultats produits par notre surveillance à base communautaire avec One Impact Bitolongi ont permis d'alimenter le nouveau plan stratégique national de la tuberculose 2021-2023 dans la partie genre et droits humains TB, mais aussi la note TB-VIH-PI pour le Fonds mondial à période 2021-2023. Donc, c'est ça qui a permis que le programme tuberculose puisse prendre les décisions programmatiques insérées dans les plans stratégiques nationaux TB et dans la note Fonds mondial. Dia suivant, je vais bientôt citer. Voilà, donc nous avons fait, dans le cadre du changement social, donc nous avons fait une évaluation initiale et une évaluation fin projet pour voir est-ce que cette intervention a apporté quelque chose. Et cette évaluation, nous l'avons fait avec les 56 utilisateurs One Impact. C'était l'échantillon, mais les 29 membres de la communauté qui ont travaillé. Et demain, déjà 23 septembre 2020, nous aurons encore un focus group avec les parties prenantes pour avoir les feedbacks afin de nous permettre d'améliorer l'intervention lors des passages à l'échelle. Alors, je vais rapidement vous dire ce qui s'est donné en termes de changement social. Donc, les malades ont vu la disponibilité des informations être améliorée parce qu'ils n'avaient pas assez d'informations, mais l'outil a l'information. Donc, vous voyez, c'est passé de 2 à 4. Et ils ont vu aussi qu'il y avait une connexion avec les pairs et les pairs éducateurs, d'autres patients. Là aussi, chacun était individuel, mais après, avec One Impact, il y a eu des connexions, des communications, et ça passait de 4. Mais aussi, il y a eu les problèmes qui pouvaient bien être, voilà, pour signaler les problèmes sans problème. Ils étaient habiles maintenant. Avec l'outil, les malades se sentent à l'aise de participer, d'être impliqués dans la lutte parce qu'ils signalent tous les problèmes qu'ils expérimentent. Là aussi, ils ont dit ils sont bien. Et nous avons aussi la réponse des malades qui ont été satisfaits de la façon dont la communauté, les acteurs communautaires leur apportaient des solutions aux problèmes signalés. Voilà, ça c'est en termes des patients. En termes des acteurs communautaires, il y a aussi un changement. Dia suivant, il y a aussi une amélioration. Diapo suivant. Voilà, les membres des communautés aussi, ils se sont vus renforcés en termes de l'information parce que l'outil One Impact contient dans sa module toutes les informations sur la tuberculose, mais aussi la façon de répondre aux différents obstacles qu'expérimentent les patients. Ça aussi, ils ont eu parce que maintenant, les patients étaient très ouverts pour signaler leurs problèmes. Membres de la communauté et les membres de la communauté étaient aptes pour répondre. Il y a aussi les problèmes sur la réaction. Avant, c'était après 72 heures pour que nous puissions réagir, pour que la communauté accompagne les malades dans le suivi. Mais maintenant, avec l'application, c'est plus rapide. En 48 heures ou même moins, on peut déjà être au chevet des malades de la tuberculose pour les suivre, pour les accompagner. Voilà, de ce côté-là. Et au niveau du personnel, Club des Amis d'Amiens, il y a aussi une amélioration. Donc, l'outil a amélioré la capacité de malades pour assurer le soutien de malades, mais aussi pour avoir l'efficacité sur les réponses à donner aux problèmes des malades. Ça aussi, c'est jusqu'à 5. Il y a aussi les problèmes sur les données, parce que maintenant, c'est un système électronique et à temps réel, on a des données sur les obstacles à travers cet outil. Mais aussi, nous avons eu être dans différents challenges. Donc, les décisions sont prises au niveau du programme. Il y a une prise en compte des problèmes des malades dans la planification, dans la programmation du programme de la tuberculose, et ça, vraiment, on est très content, et c'est grâce à cette expérience. Voilà, dia suivant. Et donc, nous passons directement à l'échelle. Donc, le projet pilote a pris fin en 2019. Maintenant, nous avons eu les leçons apprises au niveau de l'intervention, au niveau de l'outil. C'est ce que je venais de dire dans le tableau. Nous passons dia suivant. Dia suivant. Ça, je venais d'en parler déjà. Dia suivant. Voilà, donc ce projet pilote nous a permis maintenant de passer à l'échelle. Nous avons, avec l'appui des Stop TB Partnership avec Talents Facility for Civil Society, dès cette année, nous allons aller dans des provinces, Kinshasa et Congo Central. Et l'année prochaine, avec les grands fonds mondiaux, il y a 4 provinces qui seront appuyées. C'est Nord Kivu, Ituri, Maniema et Kadal qui vont implémenter la surveillance base communautaire avec l'application One Impact TB Tolongi. Donc, c'est pour dire que la RDC, il est parti maintenant pour généraliser cette expérience qui a donné de ses preuves, surtout pour la collecte électronique des données et des obstacles de malade. Merci beaucoup en tout cas pour vous. Je pense que ça a pris un peu beaucoup de temps, mais c'était important vu que c'était aussi en français. Merci à vous pour votre attention.
So yes, you can go ahead.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you so much, Maxime, for sharing experience of One Impact as a community-led monitoring tool that has supported in monitoring the TB health and the quality of health TB services in DRC. I hope we've learned a lot. It was very comprehensive. Thanks for also sharing the findings of the CLM. Let's now hear from Ayo from Nigeria, who's also going to share with us on how Nigeria has engaged in the community-led monitoring initiative. Over to you, Ayo, and I think because of time, let's try to summarize and also have an opportunity for people to ask questions. In case you have any question, please drop it in the Q&A section. Thank you. Ayo, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Because time has gone, and also some of the things I would have been speaking to have been touched by earlier speakers, I will just summarize. I'm speaking generally on community-based monitoring with a few examples of what we've done in Nigeria. Community-based monitoring, or otherwise known as community-led monitoring, refers to a set of activities by which the end users, that is the communities, community-based organizations, beneficiaries, they monitor the quality, the availability, and suitability of services. CLM or CBM, whatever you call it, either of the two is okay, focuses on client satisfaction and perceptions of services rendered. It promotes the perspectives of and participation and ownership of the communities. This is different from what we do in monitoring and evaluation, which focuses on a top-down approach. We'll come to that later. But in community-led monitoring, we are leading first with the communities. And it helps us to ensure that the clients, the communities, the service recipients are satisfied with the quality, with the quantity of services being received. So we enter into service provision from the prism of the community members. Global Fund describes it as a process by which service users or local communities gather and use information on service provision or information on local conditions impacting on service provision in order to improve the responsiveness, equity, and quality of service and hold service providers to account. Let's move on. Next slide. What community-based monitoring is not? It is not community-based service delivery. It's not talking just about going to the communities and delivering services, distributing long-lasting insecticide treated nets, holding community mobilization activities. That is not what it is. It is not monitoring and evaluation. Asking questions to provide answers to meet the requirements of certain indicators, output indicators, outcome indicators, monitoring whether activities are going along plans, evaluating the impact. That's not what community-based monitoring is. And it's not quality control, it's not data quality assurance, it's not service provider supervision. Those are concepts that we are used to, that we've used all these years. But community-based monitoring is different. What are the peculiarities of community-based monitoring? One is a bottoms-up approach. Rather than starting from the top and going down, we start from the communities and go up. It focuses, number two, on quality suitability, and utilization of services and commodities based on local realities. Community-based approach is factored into the realities of what we have in the communities. Now, it strengthens community participation and ownership of services delivered. It enables community and local contributions and investments in healthcare. This is very, very, very important. In a lot of interventions that we do, the communities see us as donors. We come and do things for them. We deliver nets, we distribute nets, and their own is to receive. But with the community-based monitoring, the communities see themselves as owners, as like in economics, they are investors. So they also will invest and contribute. So it promotes that whole concept of community investment in health. And community-based monitoring is linked closely with advocacy. One of the differences between community-based monitoring and the classic traditional MIE is that when we do MIE, we find out what does not go right or what is going right, and then we submit the reports to the donor or to the government, to the principal recipient, sub-recipient, whoever, and then we've done our job. But a basic component of community-based monitoring is advocacy. In fact, if you take community-based monitoring and you break it into two, you have one side accountability and the next side advocacy. The two are linked, two sides of that coin. Let's move forward. So like we said, in the coin that is called community-based monitoring, on is advocacy. So what is accountability? It is an assurance that an individual or an organization will be evaluated on their performance or behavior related to something for which they are responsible. It involves being answerable to all of an organization's stakeholders for all actions and results. It is important in evaluating the ongoing effectiveness of public officials or bodies. It ensures that they are performing to their full potential, providing value for money, instilling confidence in the government, and being responsive to the community. So accountability is what helps us to assure that individuals, organizations, government entities, corporates are actually doing what they are supposed to do. But it's important that you cannot hold someone or an organization accountable for an action or a result or a behavior for which they are not responsible. So there is that element of responsibility. You are responsible for something, then you are accountable for it. Then you are answerable for that thing for which you are responsible. So the concepts of responsibility and answerability are what makes up accountability. You are responsible, you are answerable. Let's move forward. Next slide. Okay. Like I said earlier, the accountability involves two stages, answerability. Then there is also enforcement. When you are answerable, you're answerable for the obligations or things that you are responsible to. Then there is also the element of enforcement. For you to be accountable, or for us to hold someone accountable, that means that we have the power, the authority, to be able to sanction that offending party. If an organization does not do what it's supposed to do, if, for instance, a sub-recipient does not distribute the nets it's supposed to distribute, or does not carry out the testings that it's supposed to do, or community mobilization, if we are going to hold that organization accountable, we have to have the ability to sanction, to call them to account, to make them pay in some way for for being derelict in their duty. But in this case, as civil society organizations, we do not have that power, that enablement to hold government accountable, to sanction government. We can hold them accountable, but we cannot punish, for instance, the state government if it does not do what it's supposed to do, or the local government, or even the principal recipient. How do we do that? That takes us to the next item. Let's move forward. So if we cannot punish the government, if we cannot sanction them, we have a very important tool, which is advocacy. Advocacy is an activity by which an individual or group that aims to, is an activity by an individual or group that aims to influence decisions within political, economic, and social systems. It represents a series of actions that we can take and issues that we can highlight to change a what is situation into what should be. We find out through our accountability actions, this is what is on the ground. Nets are supposed to be distributed to 1,200 households, but we find out that nets were distributed to 500 households. For 700 households, the nets are still languishing in a warehouse. That is what is. But we want to change it to what should be for those nets to go to the additional 700 households. Then advocacy is what enables us to get decision makers, grant implementers, or whoever is responsible to do what they should be, what they should do. So key decision makers react to credible groups or individuals who most effectively bring their issues to the forefront of the public agenda. One of the things that we do best as civil society is shaping the public agenda. Now, as we implement community-based monitoring, we take it down to the grassroots. You remember we said this is a bottoms-up approach. So from the community level, from the local government, we shape the agenda of the community. We shape the agenda of the local government. We shape the agenda of the state government as regards malaria. So we find out what is, and we use our advocacy prowess, our capability to advocate, to lobby, to put pressure, to influence the landscape, to change that situation into what we want it to be. Let's move forward. Now, what are the mechanisms for implementing the community-based monitoring? One, we said, is community-led, is structured and systematic. It does not work just anyhow. It's not haphazard. It is systematic, it's structured. And it works best through community observatories or teams. In Nigeria, we have our community observatories. We call them community accountability teams. Each team is made up of three individuals, a representative of the community, a representative of the government through the World Development Committee, and then a representative of the civil society organization of the CBO, who is the leader of the team. So that team is that community observatory, is that team that works in each community that they focus on. And they use a set of tools that have been pre-designed. Each team covers a geographic area, and they target a set of stakeholders, service providers, and service recipients, government, and healthcare providers in their focal areas. According to Global Fund, many CBM activities have centered around the quality of client experience at facilities, the quality of systems, the quality of programs, and availability of essential drugs. And that is precisely what we do in Nigeria. We focus on, hello? Zainabu, I've lost the slide, but I'll continue. We focus.
Please go ahead, we have a technical issue, but please go ahead. Continue, thank you.
Okay. We focus on the on the or on the facility using what we call the client exit interviews. We interview service recipients from the facilities, and they answer a specific set of questions which are designed to elicit and to know how effective the services they have received are. Then we use the key informant interviews, which also focuses on the personnel of the facility to find out the conditions of service, the working conditions. And many times we blame the service providers at the facilities without understanding the conditions under which they serve. Then we also work with the communities through focus group discussions, by which we also have a set of questions that the community themselves tell us. So by triangulating between these three, the service recipient, the service provider, and the community, it gives us a clear view of what the quality, the quantity of services and of the service providers are. Please, please move forward. You are back by two slides or three. So those are the areas we focus on, the community, the primary healthcare center, which is the facility, and then the people. One thing that I need to say, please move forward, Zinabu. You are going backwards. Yes, okay, here. Let's stop here. One of the things that is important in community-led monitoring is that it puts people above programs. It's about the people. It's about the quality of service that they receive. Now, in our accountability focus in Nigeria, we focus on four issues. One, value for money. Are the service providers, the sub-recipients, the healthcare providers, are they giving value for the money invested by global funds, by the government of Nigeria? Number two, we focus on the utilization of commodities by the communities. Many times in our accountability and monitoring and evaluation procedures, we overlook the communities and we do not find out how communities use the resources we give them. A peculiar problem in Nigeria is that many communities use the long-lasting nets for so many other things rather than sleeping inside. They use it for clothing, they use it for fishing, they use it for gardening. And if the community members do not sleep inside these nets, then everything we have done is a failure. So we make it a priority to ensure that we hold community members accountable. Then, of course, availability of human resources, which is provided by the local government in our healthcare system in Nigeria. In many instances, the local government do not provide the staff. So even when the commodities are provided by global funds, there's simply nobody to dispense because the local government have not provided the staff. We hold the local government accountable for putting staff members there. And lastly, budgetary appropriations and domestic resourcing. We hold the state and local governments accountable for putting money. We do not want a situation to subsist where it's Global Fund, World Bank, and all these other partners who are funding malaria interventions in Nigeria. We work with the government at state, local government levels, and the communities to also put their own resources in malaria. Let's move forward. Okay. So, whilst we wait for the slide to, okay. Now, the merits, according to Global Fund, which align with what we have seen in Nigeria, so we just adopted this. It helps us to collect, to assess, and to triangulate data and observations, both quantitative and qualitative, towards program oversight, and to improve policies and procedures. Like I've said, when we collect information using the tools, using the mechanisms, working with the communities, with the facilities, with the government, the information that we collect is not written as a report back to the principal recipient. It is the observatories, the community accountability teams, they turn this information around and they use it to improve the grant performance in those local areas. they also use those to impact the state governments and the service providers to show them how the procedures and the policies need to improve to make the grant more effective real time. It supports gathering crucial data that the health system often do not have access to, especially around key populations and under other underserved groups. The top-down approach does not really have the capability to know what the local people are feeling, what they understand, and what they believe. But the bottom-up approach enables us to have the information. We even through this understand why community members many times do not sleep inside the nets that we provide for them. Then the costs are modest in comparison to the traditional methods that are used for MIE. Let's move forward. Okay, let's move forward. Next slide. Now, why is this slide is moving? One of the things that we've seen in Nigeria, okay, from our own experience, is that using the community-based monitoring approach, which we call accountability and advocacy model, it has contributed immensely to increased budgetary allocation for malaria by state governments. So many state governments have improved the allocation to malaria just because our people asked. Advocacy works when it's based on realities. Number two, it has improved community involvement and contribution towards improved health outcomes, which includes but are not limited to community contribution, provision of ad hoc staff. As I said earlier, the local governments are supposed to recruit not have the resources to hire additional staff. Because of the advocacy efforts of our community-based organizations, many communities put their resources to hire staff to support what the government is doing. When they find out that they can do that and they know it's in their best interest. So the community is investing. They are not just takers. They are not just receivers, but they are also investors in their own health outcomes. We have successful resolution of community disputes and conflicts, which leads to improved access and uptake of services. We have improved government participation and commitment at local government level, which has led to improved collaboration between government and communities. Then we've been able to witness improved linkages between sub-recipients and then between sub-recipients and relevant stakeholders at state and local government levels. Again, it's all led to improved government commitment and improved service provision and uptake at the primary health care centers. And we have seen situations where government now is promptly attending to issues identified which affect the effectiveness of malaria interventions. All said, what we have seen is a massive community level improvement in uptake of services in areas where we work. The challenges we have now is that the percentage of funding from even Global Fund to communities is so minute. Less than 2% of the funds go to communities. The small percentage that goes to the community is outperforming. So we are now in a situation where we are making advocacy to Global Fund, to the country coordinating mechanism, and to the processes of developing the next grant that the Global Fund must make more investment in communities. Because if we are able to widen the scope, increase the number of communities and local governments where we work, the returns will be massive. Because already from the little, it has caught the attention of the Global Fund that this is a good, this is gives good value for money and it's a good investment of resources. Let me stop here. Thank you. Over.
Hello?
I say over. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ayo. Thank you very much. As usual, it's a pleasure to have you. Thank you so much. So we'll move on to the next presentation.
So we have an experience on Central African Republic with Syriac Ngombe from the organization of PALCA. I think he will speak in French. So nous avons Monsieur Syriac Ngombe de la République Centrale Africaine. Donc il va faire la présentation orale en français. Monsieur Syriac, vous avez la parole. Merci.
Okay, so everyone, please switch back to the English and the translator, please translate in English. Donc, tu peux traduire en anglais. Maintenant, il va faire la présentation en français. Okay. Syriac, essaye, je sais que... I know we know in Central African Republic, sometimes there's a huge internet issue. So we'll give you just a minute so that you can connect. Donc, Syriac, vas-y, tu peux essayer de parler.
C'est bon?
Oui, parfait.
Ok, bonjour à tous. Merci pour l'occasion que vous donnez à la République centrafricaine pour qu'on puisse exposer notre expérience en matière de suivi communautaire. En fait, c'est une expérience qui est portée par l'Organisation nationale ANJIFAS, Association nationale des jeunes femmes en Centrafrique. Et actuellement, nous sommes dans une dynamique où on intègre plusieurs organisations, dont Senina Maingo et Batagui, des enfants vivant avec le VIH/SIDA, pour avoir une plateforme de suivi communautaire de l'accès aux soins et au traitement du VIH, de la tuberculose et du paludisme. Donc, il s'agit d'un observatoire nommé TARCA. Donc, en anglais, c'est un label, ça veut dire que Treatment Access Watch, observer l'accès au traitement. C'est un observatoire qui se développe en consortium avec le Cameroun, la RDC et la Centrafrique.
Voilà. Bien. Ok, si j'ai s'il te plaît, si tu peux parler juste. Oui, si tu peux parler doucement, parce que comme il y a l'interprète qui traduit en même temps, tu peux juste parler doucement. Merci beaucoup.
D'accord, c'est mon tour. Donc, tout à l'heure, je parlais qu'en Centrafrique, on a eu une expérience d'un observatoire communautaire dénommé TAO RCA. Et TAO, ça veut dire, en anglais, c'est Treatment Access Watch. En français, c'est observer l'accès à traitement. Le TAO est développé en consortium dans trois pays.
Excuse-moi, je pense que vous avez deux machines allumées dans votre bureau. Donc, peut-être si une personne peut muter son micro. Je ne sais pas si c'est Christiane là-bas, ou, mais on entend deux sons en fait qui viennent de toi.
Oui, oui,
oui. C'est bon. Ok, c'est parfait maintenant. Vas-y, s'il te plaît. Merci.
Merci, voilà. Bien. Donc, voilà. Le problème que TAO cherche à répondre, c'est d'abord tout le fardeau qui est porté par les usagers des services de santé. On a vu que les usagers des services de santé portent les factures élevées, c'est-à-dire que les surcoûts, je voulais dire, des frais de prestation. Il y a les ruptures, récurrentes. Il y a aussi les aspects de mauvais accueil au niveau des formations sanitaires. Il y a aussi les cas de non-respect de la gratuité. Voilà. Tout ça, ce sont des fardeaux qui sont supportés par les usagers des services de santé et la communauté. Voilà. Et nous avons devant les usagers des services de santé qui portent ce fardeau, un ensemble de spectateurs, ça veut dire les décideurs politiques, les décideurs, qu'on appelle détenteurs d'enjeux, et d'autres personnels de santé qui sont là en train de regarder ces usagers de services en spectateurs. Et le rôle de l'observateur communautaire, c'est d'attirer l'attention du fardeau qui est en train de porter les usagers, pour que tous ces détenteurs d'enjeux qui sont en train de regarder ces usagers en termes d'exploiteurs puissent vraiment à la fin venir soutenir les usagers des services pour alléger le fardeau qui pèse sur eux afin qu'ils puissent avoir accès aux soins et aux traitements de qualité. Voilà. Donc, le TAORC a déjà 3 ans d'expérience. On tient l'approche basée sur la mise en place d'un dispositif de veille communautaire qui collecte des données, qui collecte des données et fait la division. Il y a également un plaidoyer qui se fait sur le dysfonctionnement pour apporter des solutions. Il y a aussi une approche qui concerne la sensibilisation des usagers de services, c'est-à-dire que plus ils connaissent leurs droits, quand ils arrivent dans une autre santé, ils doivent savoir quel est le service, qu'est-ce qu'ils doivent payer, qu'est-ce qu'ils ne doivent pas payer, et réclamer leurs droits lorsque cela est violé. Et nous avons une approche qui permet aussi de faire la promotion des bonnes pratiques. Ça veut dire que s'il y a des formations sanitaires qui ont des bonnes pratiques comme d'accueil, d'accueil d'orientation, prise en charge, etc. Nous faisons cette commission de manière que les autres formations sanitaires puissent copier l'exemple. Donc, vous comprenez que l'observatoire communautaire est d'abord basé sur la production des données. Comment les données sont produites par l'observatoire TAO? D'abord, il y a les observateurs qui sont les agents observateurs qui sont formés. Ils ont formé sur ces 3 pathologies. Ils sont formés sur les indicateurs de contrôle de la qualité de la prise en charge de ces différentes pathologies. Nous avons une base de données qui est créée en fonction de ces différents indicateurs de suivi de la disponibilité et de l'accessibilité, parce que le RCA suit la disponibilité et l'accessibilité au traitement. Et ces observateurs ont une fiche de rapport d'observation qui reprend un peu les indicateurs qui sont observés et ils font des descentes d'observation à visage découvert dans les formations sanitaires. Et une fois qu'ils collectent les données auprès, premièrement, prioritairement auprès des usagers, parce que TAO est basé sur le prisme de patient. Et après, les données sont analysées et traitées et sont produits mensuellement en termes de bulletin de l'observatoire qu'on appelle le TAO RCA. Et après, le bulletin TAO RCA, je voulais dire, et c'est diffusé à travers un mailing list et par courrier physique à certains partenaires. Voilà.
OK, il nous reste quelques secondes pour conclure, s'il te plaît.
Oui, oui. Maintenant, pour conclure, c'est pour dire que quand les données du TAO relèvent les dysfonctionnements et les manquements, nous, on adresse ça à travers des conférences de presse qui permettent un peu de présenter la situation de la prise en charge de ces pathologies au niveau national. On organise également des rencontres, des réunions avec les différents responsables des formations sanitaires qui assurent la prise en charge sur les résultats des observations pour permettre de manière qu'ils puissent avoir des décisions ou des mesures correctrices. On diffuse des communiqués de presse si cela est important. Et on envoie aussi des mails d'alerte aux responsables au niveau de la santé en termes d'action de plaidoyer ou peut-être d'interpellation pour apporter un changement. Voilà. Donc, TAO est actuellement au niveau de Bangui avec le Fonds mondial d'extension au niveau des provinces. Mais il faut noter que l'Observatoire a permis d'apporter beaucoup de changements en termes de l'accueil des patients. Et c'est un dispositif qui a permis d'alerter le ministère de la Santé à chaque fois qu'il y a des problèmes de rupture dans les formations sanitaires. Et je pense que c'est un rôle que la communauté joue pour donner sa solution en termes d'implication de la gouvernance sanitaire concernant les trois protégés qui sont appuyés par le Fonds mondial. Voilà la petite expérience que je voulais partager pour conclure.
D'accord, merci beaucoup, merci. Merci à vous, merci pour cette expérience de la République centrafricaine. Et là, so we'll give back the floor to Olive. Olive, for the slides that you present, and I will hand back to the moderator of the webinar.
Thank you so much for that example of the CLM. So I see time has gone, and at this time would like to open up for questions and answers, and looking at the Q&A, there are only a few questions of requesting for us to share with the presentation in English, which I've already said that we'll share with you all the presentation. Yeah. So before I call upon Olive, I just want to know if there is anyone with a burning question. You can put up your hand and let's give it 5 minutes, and then after we'll hear from Olive, who give us a recap of the what is CLM, as well as introduce to us, give us an introduction of the community-led monitoring guide. Yes.
Go ahead, and then I will read the question in French and translate in English. Go ahead.
Proceed, Olivia, because there was a question I saw from Olivia from Olaide, which was addressed to Maxime. So maybe we may want to check in the chat box.
Yes. So we're seeing all the questions here. The question from Maxime. Okay. So maybe I can go through the whole questions then to make it easier. So first question was in French is comment les OFC peuvent accéder à l'assistance technique du Fonds mondial? So Olive, I think that one is for you. You can answer it. It's how civil society organization can access technical assistance of the Global Fund in terms of community-based management. So the second question for Maxime was, Maxime, peut-on avoir can you tell us, est-ce qu'on peut avoir des grandes lignes de l'impact du projet One Impact? So Maxime, can you tell us more about the impact of the One Impact project?
Okay, je peux répondre ou bien...
Oui, oui, vas-y.
Merci. Je pense que je l'ai quand même souligné dans ma présentation. Les grandes lignes du projet, c'est d'abord la faisabilité qu'il faut réussir à avoir par rapport à l'outil, la contextualisation de l'outil que nous avons réussi avec donc à adapter l'outil One Impact dans le contexte de la RDC avec les directives nationales en matière de la tuberculose dans les pays. Et aussi, il faut être sûr sur l'utilisation de l'outil par les patients, les malades de la tuberculose. Je vis une autre question, c'était, est-ce qu'il faut seulement avoir les smartphones pour télécharger? Eh bien oui, parce que c'est une application numérique, c'est digital, c'est téléphonique, c'est avec smartphone pour télécharger. Donc, ça nous a permis quand même, notre grande ligne, d'avoir aujourd'hui des données à temps réel sur les obstacles qu'expérimentent les malades. Ça aussi, c'est une grande ligne de projet parce que ça donne des informations au pays aujourd'hui, à tous les décideurs, et que ça soit du programme national, donc du ministère de la Santé, mais aussi des décideurs de la société civile que nous sommes pour un bon plaidoyer. Donc ça aussi, c'est des évidences qui font partie plutôt des grandes lignes du projet One Impact. Deuxièmement, c'est les résultats dans les changements. Dans les changements, donc, on a atteint un niveau aujourd'hui où les malades, avec One Impact, peuvent dire oui, je suis impliqué, j'ai les informations sur la tuberculose, je connais entre autres mes droits et j'ai des gens qui peuvent m'écouter, me répondre et aussi m'apporter des solutions par rapport à ma prise en charge de la tuberculose. Et la communauté aussi, elle se sent renforcée parce que maintenant, elle a des arguments pour affronter, pas affronter, mais participer au fait dans la planification, dans la réponse avec les évidences provenant des malades, donc parce que le soin est centré sur la personne malade de la tuberculose. Ensuite, nous avons, parce que les évidences, ils font les exploiter, les données. Et aujourd'hui, nous alimentons le plan stratégique national de la tuberculose et même d'autres mécanismes de financement dans le fonds mondial avec les évidences, donc les données provenant des personnes affectées par la tuberculose. Donc voilà, mais les étapes de One Impact sont connues pour la mise en œuvre. Ça a été brossé par Keva et par moi-même dans les projets. Donc voilà un peu. Mais les indicateurs aussi sont bien définis avec les utilisateurs, donc les malades de la tuberculose, pour un bon suivi. Il ne faut pas que ce soit des indicateurs imposés par la hiérarchie. La verticalisation de la lutte, nous l'avons déjà décriée. La lutte doit être horizontale pour espérer la participation de tout le monde, surtout les personnes affectées par la tuberculose. Merci.
Merci beaucoup, Maxime. So there was a question for you still, Maxime, on so giving that the One Impact application can only be downloaded on for smartphone users. Yeah. How were you able to capture the view and barriers experienced by TB patients in those communities who may not have smartphones and who are not able to download the application? Donc, dans les communautés qui ne peuvent pas avoir...
J'ai compris.
Oui, c'était pour les, autres, oui.
Ah, OK. Vous pouvez dire, alors, les communautés qui ne peuvent pas télécharger, oui, vous pouvez.
Voilà. Donc, dans les communautés qui ne peuvent pas avoir les téléphones, les smartphones, les téléphones intelligents, comment est-ce que vous avez fait pour collecter les données?
OK. Donc, c'est tout à fait ça, au fait. Donc, dans la faisabilité pour expérimenter la surveillance à base communautaire, il faut d'abord savoir si la communauté a accès au téléphone avec Android, donc smartphone. C'est ce que nous avons fait. Nous avons au Congo plus de 60% de la population qui utilise les smartphones, ce qui rend aussi facile la mise en œuvre de l'expérience, très important. Parce qu'il faut que ce soit l'individu qui signale son problème. Évidemment, dans les projets pilotes, on ne pouvait pas demander aux malades de signaler les problèmes de leur prochain. Parce que dans les centres de santé, on avait limité à 10 malades de la tuberculose, alors que les centres de santé contient plus de malades. Mais il n'est pas indiqué un malade puisse signaler le problème d'un autre parce qu'il n'a pas les smartphones, parce que c'est son nom qui est donné et on va aller vers lui pour porter la solution alors que ce n'est pas lui. Ce qui est mieux, c'est qu'on ne peut que télécharger l'application avec les smartphones et il faut conseiller aux gens d'avoir ces smartphones. S'il y a un problème de connexion Internet, il y a un problème de possession des smartphones, alors évidemment, il est difficile d'implémenter la surveillance à base communautaire à travers l'outil One Impact TB. Mais au Congo, ce n'est pas le cas. Au Congo, la population a l'accès à l'Internet, l'accès à smartphone, et puis ils aiment utiliser cela. C'est vrai qu'il y a un problème de rupture de courant électrique, mais ce n'est pas tous les mois. Donc, on peut toujours signaler son problème et quand on a l'électricité, on allume son téléphone et on peut le faire. Merci.
OK, thank you, Maxime. So the other question is from Amza. Is the report you produce from the data collected by community health workers, are they validated by health workers? Donc, est-ce que les données des agents de santé communautaire sont validées par les agents de santé? Donc, peut-être Hamza voulait parler peut-être du ministère de la Santé.
C'est pour moi.
Donc, les données sont data collected from community health workers are they validated by the health, probably the Ministry of Health.
OK, mais je pense quand nous voyons la plateforme, déjà l'utilisation implique les agents de santé directement. Les infirmiers sont là. C'est vrai qu'ils ne participent pas dans l'utilisation de l'outil, mais ils sont déjà informés de la surveillance à base communautaire qui habilite les malades à signaler les problèmes dans leur centre de santé parce qu'ils y sont soignés. Deuxièmement, les agents de santé communautaires, c'est eux qui accompagnent les malades pour répondre à leurs problèmes. Troisièmement, il y a les clubs des amis d'Amiens, le staff, qui a les tableaux de bord, qui centralisent les données et pour apporter un plaidoyer au niveau du programme. Et le programme a aussi les codes, donc il peut, les programmes accèdent journalièrement dans les dashboards One Impact TB, avant même que les plaidoyers soient menés et le programme a l'information sur les données. Maintenant, la validation des données, mais c'est le malade qui donne, signale les problèmes. Il ne faut pas que le système de santé dise non, c'est faux son problème. Non, c'est vrai son problème. Il y a rupture de médicaments, il a les effets indésirables de son traitement causé par des médicaments. Donc, c'est les malades qui informent les programmes. En fait, la communauté, il n'est qu'un pont pour permettre au programme d'améliorer sa prise en charge, la qualité de son service. Donc, voilà un peu. Donc, ce qui est donné est suivi par tout le monde est participant dans la surveillance à base communautaire à travers One Impact.
Merci beaucoup Maxime pour tes réponses et ta très bonne présentation.
Il y a eu
toutes les questions étaient pour ta présentation, donc merci beaucoup. Et si vous avez d'autres questions, on pourra toujours envoyer à Maxime par email après le webinaire. Merci pour ta participation. So we have Olive. There was one question for you. Maybe you can take it right after, right before you talk about your slide. About how civil society can access global fund technical assistance on community-based, on community-led monitoring activities. We saw one hand. I don't know if the person would like to speak. It's a phone Galaxy S8. So if you'd like to speak, we will allow you to speak now. If you can do it very quickly. Otherwise, we're moving on to conclude the webinar with Olive.
Hello.
Yeah. Hello.
S'il vous plaît, allez-y très rapidement.
Hello. Can I go ahead?
Yes, we can hear you. Please go quickly.
Is that okay then? CLM has been proven to be effective. Looking at the successes and improvements, the fact that communities are beginning to take ownership of their activities. Now, what are donors doing to strengthen the system? Yes, that is the question. Thank you.
Thank you. So the sound is not very good. So if you want to write on the chat, please. Because we couldn't really hear you. So if you can please write on the chat and then Olive will answer your question after. Thank you so much. So yeah, Olive, go ahead.
Yeah, Olivia, thank you so much. I think that question can go to Kiva. Not that Kiva is a donor, but then just from Stop TV partnership, like what do they see as the role of supporting communities in community-based monitoring. So maybe Kiva, you can come in.
Sure, Olive, thank you. And thank you for the question. I think
Well, I can only speak for Stop TB, obviously, but what we are trying to do is to, as I was mentioning, finalize first and foremost this framework, sort of putting together ideas and concepts and objectives and so on and so forth. The other thing that we're doing is, and so we will be available to share that framework while people translate it into various languages. We're also finalizing the platform, again, based on country experiences. We're making it adaptable and flexible so that countries can use it and change it for their particular uses. So any country can access this framework, and any country can access this platform and the source code and whatever comes along with it. So that will be made available to countries. The other thing that we can do is via various initiatives like what we have in Stop TB, like the Challenge Facility for Civil Society, which is a call to communities and civil society to implement and to support engagement in community monitoring in TB, but it can also be in TB and malaria and HIV and so on and so forth. So countries are welcome to apply to this funding. TB Reach is also another initiative that countries can use. We can also use our advocacy platform. We have a global platform where we can connect and share best practices. And I think by building all of this information and sharing broadly with each other and connecting with each other, which is why I think the webinars like this are super helpful to hear from Nigeria, super helpful to hear from you all about all this work that you are doing. And so this is another way, I think, for us to get messages out there and to be able to share and learn. But that is it, I think, from the perspective of Stop TB. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Olivia. Thank you so much, Kiva. I'm taking it on from Olivia. Zainab, if you can put on my one slide. But just to quickly say that in terms of the question on technical support, I know that the Global Fund, as I had presented, is coming up with a technical assistance module, which is called community-led monitoring. It is starting in January 2021. It will go up to 2023. And they are still working around the modalities. They're still working around which countries. However, from the lessons we've learned from the community rights and gender technical assistance, most likely you, first of all, will need to have already incorporated community-led monitoring into your grant. And as you want to implement, even just the minute you, during the grant making process, as long as you have included it, then they will help you to develop it further, to develop the tools in terms of the training, in terms of training for the human resources, and then also in terms of the report production. What I would like to say is Global Fund has really promoting the voices from the community. And this is because they know that communities are the ones that make a difference in terms of impact to HIV, TB, and malaria. I would also want to add on to what Kiva just mentioned in terms of accessing One Impact, TB One Impact. Here I am based in Tanzania, and we have gone through a long process of developing what we call TB Janja One Impact. And we are in the current process where Kiva has also mentioned around the Challenge Facility, where we are now looking at integrating it and moving forward with a pilot again, which will be up to next year. So as communities, as civil society, it is our responsibility, first of all, to look at systems that work. I wanted to take this opportunity to thank Maxim, Ayo, and Sirik for sharing the experiences at country level. But before I move forward, I just want to mention that IANASO, the organization I work with, in partnership with Stop TB Partnership, GIZ, Frontline AIDS, we've developed what is called a community-led monitoring guide. It takes us through step by step on what we should be doing as we develop a community-led monitoring guide. We will be having a proper launch of the guide, and it is going to be translated in various languages, French, Portuguese, English, Spanish, and probably Arabic. We're still in that those discussions. However, if you look in front in terms of the slide, it is all around, the very first thing is community and government orientation and empowerment. For us as communities and the government to understand why community-led monitoring is crucial in terms of grant effectiveness. And then after that, you come, you sit, you develop a plan, and you conceptualize how you want your community-based or community-led monitoring mechanism to look like. And then from there, you sit with stakeholders, you carry out an analysis on their engagement, you sit with your stakeholder and carry out a stakeholder analysis and see where stakeholders will engage. And then after that, you've developed your process, then you collect data, you triangulate it, and then you have your report. After the report, you share it with various stakeholders, decision makers, people from the community, and then you influence policies, strategies, programs. And then after you've done that, you follow up and you see whether whatever you had inputted, whatever comments or recommendations that you had put in is really making a difference. And then that is the time now when you do the M&E of the CBM CLM process. I just wanted us to finalize with this slide because it is very, very key for us as communities, especially malaria communities. I want to challenge you all. I know that within the countries, there are community-led monitoring systems. We may call them differently, but do we know them and how are we engaging with them? But secondly, how are we scaling them up? The big, we've gotten examples from TB, and I think the biggest challenge that we have right now is making sure that we integrate all our tools so that we are working around HIV, TB, and malaria. With that, Olivia, I just wanted to say thank you from IANASO's side. Thank you to everyone that participated in this call, and thank you to the team, both Impact Center team and IANASO team, and also for the participants, and also mainly to all the presenters for being here and for the extra time you had to sit to be in this call. On my side, I say thank you so much. Over to you, Olivia.
Yes, thank you, Liv. Thank you, Enyaso, all our wonderful speakers. We were very happy to have you. And thanks to our Francophone colleagues who were able to join us today. So thank you so much. And Stop TB as well. So we look forward to work again with Enyaso and then come back to you with some follow-up. But we really hope that each of you will take what you learn today and really use it to make something meaningful for our communities. We will share everything as usual by email, all the presentation, the audio, everything. You have everything. Please go through it again and then make sure that you use some of those findings in your work so that you can improve programs for the communities that you serve. Merci, merci beaucoup, merci à tous. Thank you, Olive, and have a great, great day, everybody. Thank you.
Merci,
merci beaucoup.
Thank you to our moderator as well. Thank you so much.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you, Yvonne. Thank you, Yvonne.
Au revoir, merci.